But this is not part of the tag, right?
No.
Do we have Lorenz Provost here? Did you upload already the talk?
You wanna go now?
You didn't, that's okay, we'll have 2 minutes.
Okay. So, first of all, I would like to thank the organizers for allowing me to present my work. My name is Zev Zalewski, I'm from Bar-Ilan University in Israel. Actually, my talk will be a direct continuation of the previous talk. I'm from the Faculty of Engineering, I like to start my talks by saying that I used to divide the world of scientists into 3 categories. They are the theoreticians, they understand everything, but nothing works because they don't do experiments. They are experimentalists that have everything working, but they don't understand why, because theory is not their strongest part. And they are engineers like myself, which is the best combination of the previous 2. Nothing works and we don't understand why. But what I'm going to speak about today is how various tricks involving wavefront shaping and playing with the polarization of light can be applicable from the engineering point of view for various applications, starting from applications as estimating distances up to applications that improve resolution of imaging systems, super resolution, as well as performing various sensing, realizing various sensing applications like detecting tumor or flow of blood, as well as concentration of glucose in bloodstream. Okay? So this is not the abstract of my talk, this is the title. The outline of my talk will be as follows. I will start by giving a short introduction, and then I'm going to speak about various applications, as I mentioned. I'm going to speak about ranging, finding the distance, super resolution flow, sensing, and glucose sensing. I will speak about things that we did long time ago, like 20 years ago. I'm much older than I look like. But also about some research, recent research activity that we are doing. Okay, so this is the second day of this workshop, so I don't really need to add a lot, but there are 2 types of angular momentum. There is the orbital one, which is more related to the optical field. And there is the spin angular momentum, which is related to the polarization. And I'm going to show you how both affecting and measuring both of those can be applicable for the applications that I have mentioned. Okay, so one of the things that we did some time ago is related to finding the range. Finding the range, the range is very important thing in various directions, starting from automatic cars, robotics, but also in medicine. And today there is a trend in which the medicine is more and more becoming automatic, in which medical doctors control the medical operation from a distance, and several people from different locations obtain information in real time about the medical procedure. So finding the range, the distance to object is very important, specifically because regular camera gives you two-dimensional image. So there are various ways of finding the distance, some of them involving optics, some of them don't. One interesting way that we were working on, which is very simple, is a way in which we engineer the wavefront of light. So we illuminate the object, and we encode the phase of the wavefront in such a way that given the size of the beam, so given the numerical aperture of the beam while propagating through the free space along the z direction, the phase is such that with the distance, the intensity is changing according to the patterns which are described here. So all you need to do is to capture the image of the object that you are illuminating in order to know what is the distance, the range, to different locations inside the object. All you need to do is to find the direction of the lines, because the direction of the lines, they are rotating with the distance, like in the clock. So if you find the direction in a certain position, you know what is the range to that specific region in your image. The question is how you can engineer your wavefront to have with Z changes going like this. This is exactly the control of the angular momentum, of the orbital angular momentum of light. So we have designed such a wavefront. There are various ways of designing the wavefront. There are more analytical ways, there are more iterative ways. One way of doing it, for instance, involves a numerical iterative algorithm like Gerbeck-Saxton, which you can use in order to converge to the distribution you want to obtain. Here you can see some results in which we illuminate our in this case, it was not an SLM, it was a fixed diffractive optical element, but of course you can do it dynamically with an SLM. You illuminate and you see that like in the previous image, like here, for different distances, those are planes at different distances, the direction of the lines is changing. The next step that we did, we installed this device inside of an automatic car that was controlled, like a robot that could move in space and estimate the distance to various objects according to the analysis that the software did of the direction of the lights. And you can see how it finds from an image the direction of the lines, and from this it estimates the distance. One of the problems of this concept, it's very simple to realize, but the problem is, or the question is, what is the resolution of the ranging that you can obtain? I mean, so the lines are rotating. You, when you design your optical element, you set a set of planes, of constraints, in which you want to design a phase that will generate the lines in certain directions. So in this case, we set six planes along different six axial locations in which we want to obtain those distributions. But does it mean that our resolution in Z estimation will be the distance divided by 6? This is not a very good resolution. So one of the things that is interesting in this concept, obviously the line are rotating in a related way to the numerical aperture of your beam. But what happens is that the distribution between this state and this state is not a random one. It is a predicted one, so the resolution you can get in Z is much higher than 6. And this is what we did about 12 years ago in this automatic car that was driving by itself and estimating the distance to various objects in the scene. So this was a control of the orbital angular momentum. The problem with that, another problem or disadvantage of the approach I mentioned in the previous slide, is the fact that we want high resolution in Z, But we want also relatively high resolution in x, y, right? We want to estimate the distance, the range, in many x and y locations. But the point is that this is a periodic pattern. So I need a certain region in which I need to generate this line that will be rotating. And this determines the resolution in x and y that we can obtain for the range estimation. One of the things that we did as next step was to design a changing distribution of primary speckle patterns. So those are the, so we have a phase element that is designed in such a way that versus Z we have a change in a random distribution. This is a speckle pattern. It looks very random, but actually it's not very random. Its statistics is Z dependent. Why should I use a random pattern? Because random pattern is not periodic in XY. And in this case, I don't have various problems related to XY resolution. So I can get the high Z resolution without being limited in XY resolution. So in this case, we built some automatic device that could analyze, so it could capture an image of speckles, make some kind of analysis about its statistics, and from the statistics, because the statistics was Z varying statistics, it could estimate the distance. In this experiment, for instance, we had objects with different heights, and you see that after looking on this object by analyzing those different speckle patterns, we could indeed find that different locations along the objects were at different distances with high precision, both in X, Y, and in Z. But you know, so finding range is important, but another interesting problem, which is also related basically to shaping the wavefront of light, which is related to orbital angular momentum, is the issue of super resolution. What is super resolution? Super resolution is, you know, when we have an imaging system, the capability to separate two points in space, in X and Y, also in Z, is dependent on two main factors. The first one is related to the numerical aperture of the imaging lens. Why is that? Because the diffraction, the angular span of the diffraction coming from a certain detail, a spatial detail in space, the angular span is related to the wavelength divided by the size of this detail. So if our lens has a given numerical aperture, this numerical aperture will be equal to the ratio between the wavelength and the smallest detail that we, in space, that we could image because of diffraction. Because lens will image only the angular span that it will capture. This will be transmitted as an image to the detector. All the rest of the angles, which are larger than the numerical aperture, will not be captured. This is one limitation of resolution. The second limitation is related to the geometry of the detector, because the detector is not a photofilter. Some of you are old enough to know that once people were capturing images with photofilms, not with digital cameras. When you have a digital camera, you have two artifacts which damage the resolution of the image, and this is what is called the geometrical limitation. One artifact is related to the fact that the analog distribution is sampled in space because we have pixels. It is true that the continuous function can be reconstructed out of its samples if Nyquist or Shannon sampling criteria is fulfilled. So you need to have the, so if you have pixels with certain density of sampling in space, this limits the maximum spatial frequency you could reconstruct. And another part of the geometric limitation of resolution is related to the fact that Nyquist was speaking about ideal sampling, but the pixels of camera do not do ideal sampling, because ideal sampling is done with an array of delta functions of Dirac. And the pixels are not a Dirac delta function, they do average over the area of the pixel. This also reduces the resolution. And the question how you can overcome this. Overcoming this is called super resolution. And there are many techniques that do super resolution. Basically, I'm not going to this because my time is short. But super resolution, what it does, it makes a conversion of degrees of freedom. You want to have more degrees of freedom in space, and you're willing to pay with some other degrees of freedom. For instance, your object is not changing in time, then let's use the time domain to improve the XY resolution. Or I don't care about color, let's use the color, the wavelength domain, to send more information that in XY I could not resolve before, and so on. So it's basically a conversion. It's like in life. You know with what you can pay, you know what you want to buy, you give money and you get what you want. Okay? And there are many ways of to do the conversion, as I said, through time, through wavelength, through polarization, and so on. One of the most common approaches for super resolution, using indeed the time domain, it is called time multiplexing. This is a field of how super resolution can be done. There are many techniques that do time multiplexing super resolution. Just to explain it in 1 minute, I want to explain it through Moiré patterns, okay? How it works to those who are not from the field of super resolution. The idea is extremely simple, as most of the things after you understand them. So let us assume that we have a pattern, an object that we want to image. Say this grating is the object I want to image. But it has very fine lines that I could not image because its periodicity is much higher than the resolution of my imaging camera, okay? And I cannot see this. But if I take another function, let's call it encoding function, like this one, and I put it on top of my object, by the way, when I say putting on top, it doesn't have to be physically putting, it can be, for instance, projected on top or some other way. If I put it on top, see what we have now? We have those large lines. Those large lines are at low resolution. Them I can image. And if I image those lines and I know the encoding pattern from this, I can reconstruct the original object. This is not exactly correct, because now, so far, time is not involved here. So what I said is correct, but not completely correct. Why it is correct? What did I do here? This is a down conversion of spatial frequencies. I had high spatial frequency, I multiplied it with another high spatial frequency, so I converted the high spatial frequency into low frequency. This is the Moiré pattern. And this is okay. The point is, what happens if in the original pattern I have not only high spatial frequency, I have also low spatial frequencies? And then I have a problem. Because if I do the down conversion, the high spatial frequency become low frequency, but the low frequency are also there, so they will be mixed together. This is the problem. This is why I need to do time multiplexing. So what is time multiplexing? I capture a set of images, not one, several, that change in time. One, a set of images of Moiré patterns, which change in time, and also the encoding pattern is changing in time, and I know what the encoding was. So I capture the set of images and I apply a decoding which matches the encoding, and from this, now I'm not joking, this is correct, I can reconstruct the original high resolution object. So I capture, for instance, one image like this, one image like this, one image like this, all those Moiré patterns, and after I have them, I can process them and do super resolution. As I said, it can be, doesn't have to, the encoding pattern doesn't have to be physically there, I can project it. The decoding can be done digitally. Just as an example, today, by the way, it is called structured illumination. People use it in microscopy, but 20 years ago when we worked on it, it was not called structured illumination, but it is structured illumination. So here, for instance, we took an object that had thick line and thin line, thick and thin line. The resolution of the imager was such that we could not see the thin line. This is what we saw, only the thick line. The thin line was filtered out. And then after projecting the encoding pattern, which was a grating in this case, and doing the post-processing, this is what we got. You see that we reconstructed the thick line as well as the thin line. And it can be applied for microscopy, of course. Here you see various examples. So you have here, two examples. In both examples, this is the high resolution reference of a bunch of cells here and here. This is how they are imaged with low numerical aperture objective. You do not see well, you cannot separate well between the cells. And then you apply the super resolution, the time multiplexing approach, in which I project my encoding pattern and do the decoding. encoding pattern, and from this I get this. From this I get this, which resembles very much the original high resolution pattern. In this case, the projection was not of a grating, but rather of a speckle pattern, like what I did for ranging. And this pattern should be changing, should be changed in time. Okay? This is how I come into this stuff related to angular momentum. So I need to have a time-changing wavefront shaping element that can shape an encoding pattern projected on top of my object, change it in time in a certain way, use it, apply it digitally as a decoding on top of a set of low resolution images I capture, I average in time, this is why it is called time multiplexing, and I get a reconstruction of super resolved image. The question is, what should be the images that I should project, should encode with the object, and to use for the decoding. So the images should be such an image, should be such images that I should need as less images as possible to do the best reconstruction possible. So you can project just random things like speckles, but actually there are better patterns to project, to encode with and to decode the image. One of the things that we recently introduced is based on bunker code. Actually, bunker code is something that came from the radar industry. Radar industry was evolving for the last 60 years. They have a lot of very interesting codes that they use in order to enhance various processes. And actually, bunker code is a certain code that with this code, you can really, with very small number of images, reconstruct with very high performance the original high resolution image. So what do? Here we take an SLM, and by applying a Gerstbeck-Saxton algorithm, we design a wavefront and a phase on top of the SLM that will encode the wavefront of light, which is illuminating the object, such that after a certain distance, which we know what the distance is, we will have the Barker code generated. This is the reference code, this is the phase of the SLM, and this is the code that we really get from this, which resembles very much the original code. And we want this code to be time-changing, so what we actually do, we design such a phase that causes this code to rotate in Z. And why is it good to rotate it in Z? It is good because if you want to obtain a 2D, so if you have an SLM, you can change things in time. Sometimes in some systems, you cannot put SLM because of limitation in speed and various other limitations. And you want to mechanically move to shift the pattern. It is simpler to shift something in Z rather than to start moving it in X, Y, because I move it in one dimension rather in two. And since I move in Z and the patterns are Z dependent because they're rotating in Z, I have the change in my encoding pattern just by shifting the fixed encoding mask that encoded the wavefront of my light, of my illuminating beam. And you can see here the performance. So this is, A is the high resolution object. This is, it is called USAF resolution target. This is how this target looks like with low resolution imager. And this is the reconstruction we get, significantly better. This is super resolution. This we get in two ways. We do it on one hand with projection, like here, and with changing the projected pattern, changing the phase on the SLM, and therefore changing the encoding, the projected encoding pattern, and therefore the decoding, and by mechanically doing the shift. So this is without SLM. We just have a fixed mask. We move it in Z. And we know how change in Z changes the encoding pattern. We use this a priori information for decoding, the reconstruction we get. Again, from a very low resolution image, this is the resolution enhancement we get, which is much better, and it approaches the original high resolution image. What is interesting with super resolution is not that it can improve the resolution of the imager, but if you have a given imager with a given resolution, which is enough for you, it can solve various aberrations that the lens of the imager can introduce. For instance, if I have a regular lens, it may have sufficient numerical aperture, and in the center of the field of view, I will have an image with sufficient resolution. Resolution which is good enough for me. But because of aberrations that I have for the lens, for instance, because of chromatic aberrations, this high-quality image will be good for one color, but if I have many colors, it will be blurred. Or because of other types of aberrations, spherical and cylindrical, I may have bad quality of image in the outer parts of my field of view. So it will be good in the center, but not in the outer part of the field of view. So one of the things that super resolution can do is, increase the OTF beyond the original OTF that the imager has in optimal conditions, but rather to increase it, because super resolution is increasing the OTF. This is why you have more resolution, you see more details, more frequencies. So to increase it such that it will compensate the reduction that the aberration made. And here I show you some experimental results. For instance, here we overcome spherical aberrations. So again, we always have in A the high resolution reference, in B is the aberrated or the low resolution image. And this is the reconstruction we get with this type of image. Again, this is done by projecting those orbital, by doing this orbital angular momentum, by shaping in Z the patterns that we are projecting. This is the encoding, and using them for the decoding. And you see that the quality of the reconstructed image is better. You can see in this case how we overcome astigmatism aberration. So this is the aberration, the aberrated images, and this is our reconstruction. This is, by the way, spherical aberration. This is astigmatism aberration. You see the quality of reconstruction, which is significantly better than the aberrated images that we have. Okay. So far, I was more talking about orbital angular momentum. Let us speak about spin angular momentum. How polarization-related effects related to a circular right and circular left polarization state, how can it be related to detection and sensing of various important parameters? One of the things that we are working on is biophotonics. We try to detect various things. We try to detect a tumor. We try to detect blood flow. We try to detect various biomedical parameters. We try to detect concentration of various chemicals in bloodstream in a non-invasive way. So one of the things that are very interesting, and I'm going to speak about it here, is detection of a tumor, and it is related to a flow of blood. What did we do? We injected nanorods, and we illuminated the region of interest with light, and we measured the polarization state through the Stokes parameter of the back reflector, of the scattered light. Now what happens? If you have nanorods, they are rods. So if light coincides, so there are two types of polarization related to the long axis and to the short axis of those rods. If there is no flow, the rods are randomly distributed. So the polarization, the degree of polarization is not changing, because some of them like this, some of them like this, some of them in the middle. But if there is a flow, because of mechanics, the nanorods would like to go with the flow velocity like this, with the smallest cross section along the flow. And this means that now they are oriented in a synchronized way. So if I will check the polarization state now, I will have a degree of polarization which is not averaged to zero like here, but rather an evident degree of polarization, like we have here. So you see here different lines. We see that the center line, this one, corresponds to nanospheres. So they don't have a difference of polarization. And then we put nanorods, and we see that when there is a flow, when there is no flow, still almost no change in degree of polarization. But when there was a flow, we see how the degree of polarization start to change. And then we took a mouse and we generated the cancer in the mouse, and we tried to, and we injected the nanorods, and we tried to detect the cancer. And you see here measurements done versus the time scale. What can you see here? So you have, for those 3 points in time, you have two types of measurements. The black, this is the degree of polarization that was measured, as I explained before. By the way, this is an in vivo experiment. So the black column is the tumor tissue. We illuminated the tumor region and we did the measurement of the degree of polarization. And the dotted, this one, is in the blood vessel. So what do we see? We see two things. First of all, we see strong change in the degree of polarization in the blood vessel because the nanorods were flowing there, as I explained. We see this after 15 minutes, 1 hour, then after 10 hours, the degree of polarization is back to normal. Why? Because there was no more nanorods there. They just were evacuated. But in the tumor, they stayed. 5 minutes, I'm almost done. In the tumor, they continue to stay, so we have a change in the degree of polarization, and this one is fixed versus time. It is not the same change as you have with the flow of vessels, but this is steady in time because the nanorods stick to the tumor. So we could detect the tumor by analyzing the change in the state of polarization. This is an example how polarization can be related to a sensing of flow and cancer. Another thing that we use polarization for in order to perform sensing is related to glucose detection. So glucose has two very interesting, the molecule of glucose has two interesting effects. First is the optical activity. What does it mean? It means that if we examine the change between the circular right and the circular left polarization, it will be related to the concentration of glucose. But this effect is a very strong effect, but there is another very interesting effect with glucose, and this is the Faraday rotation effect. What is the Faraday rotation? If we now apply an external magnetic field, we have rotation of circular right versus circular left, which is dependent on the concentration of glucose, because this is the molecule that has the effect, but it also depends on the strength of the magnetic field. The coefficient that determines this is the Verdet coefficient. So those two interesting effects, the optical activity and the Faraday rotation, we use to detect in a non-invasive way, in vivo, but also in vitro, glucose concentration in various scenarios. So here, for instance, this is one experiment in which we took a cell-containing sugar solution, illuminated with a laser. Now, how do we do the detection? We do it through analysis of the secondary spectral pattern. Secondary spectral pattern, as was explained before, is related to the waveform of light. It is interference effect. It is related to the medium that scatters light, but it is also an interference effect, and it is related to polarization. So if the polarization is changed due to what I said before, due to glucose, due to the effects I mentioned, the speckle pattern is also changing. So we analyze the speckle pattern. You see, they look random, but they are not really random. They are dependent on the concentration of glucose. This is the optical activity. No Faraday effect yet. And we see that indeed, when we change the concentration, we have a change in the speckle pattern that we measure through the correlation coefficients that we calculate, because we have the reference to which we compare the readout. And we now took a solution in which we didn't know the concentration. You see, there is a good match. It looks far away, but those are small deviations. We were able to estimate concentration of glucose with high precision. The next step is not to test the optical activity, but also to do testing using the Faraday rotation effect to try to detect in a non-invasive way in vivo sugar in blood. Okay? So what do we do? Here, at first we did it with a solution in vitro. Next step was in vivo. So we took a solution with glucose. We also added intralipids to simulate real tissue. And we applied external magnetic field at a certain AC frequency. Why AC? Because the concentration of glucose in blood is very low. We talk about 0.1% and less, okay? Like 100 milligrams per deciliter. This is very low concentration. And because it is very low concentration, the SNR would be very bad. But because our magnetic field is an AC field, and we know at which frequency we apply it, it means that the signal that we will sense will be at the frequency of the magnetic field, because it generates the Faraday rotation effect. But the noise will be spread over all frequencies, so we enhance our SNR. This is called lock-in amplification. And we can enhance the SNR significantly, signal-to-noise ratio significantly. Here we can see that at the frequency of excitation of the magnetic field, we have a peak in the spectrum. The peak was measured through secondary speckle patterns, like I explained before, the correlation which is changing in time at the frequency of the magnetic field, and the strength of the change is correlated to concentration of glucose, even though the concentration is very low. And we see how changing in the concentration of glucose changes the correlation. And this was done by putting a solution in vitro into this AC magnet, but we did it also in vivo. And it gave relatively good results for measuring in vivo, in a non-invasive way, glucose in blood arteries. And we see how, now how did we change the glucose of the subject? We just gave him something sweet to eat. So the glucose is increased, and our measurement is increased, and the repeatability of the measurement was quite good. What was interesting is that it also involves the things I mentioned before relating to the flow velocity. This is my last slide. Related to flow velocity, because if we do the measurement along the blood vein, this analysis through the secondary speckle pattern is significantly more precise. I'm summarizing my talk. So I spoke with you how one can do beam shaping and how one can do polarization shaping or sensing in optics. And this can be used for a large variety of applications, both for imaging, for super resolution, for improving aberrations, but also for biophotonic applications, to sense chemicals and flow of liquids in living tissues, to detect cancerous cells and so on. And those were the two parts of my talk. On one hand, to use orbital angular momentum to shape the wavefront of light, to change it in Z to estimate range and to improve resolution, but also to do the analysis of the spin angular momentum of the rotation of the polarization in space and in time in order to do the sensing of flow of cancer and of glucose in the bloodstream. Thank you for your time.
So we have a couple of minutes for questions.
When you mentioned about using rods blood flow. What kind of material should we use? What is the size of the stuff?
The nanorod. It was made out of gold. It was made out of gold. Okay. So it is used in medical applications. It goes to the liver and then it is ejected out of the body. So it's medically. This process is medically adapted. Usage of gold. The dimensions of the nanoparticles, nanorods that we used, were approximately something like they were very small. The dimensions were matched to the wavelength that we were using. So you can change the dimensions depending on the wavelength of your laser. But we used something which was approximately 30, 40 nanometers over a few nanometers because this was the laser, the wavelength of the laser we had. But this can be changed.
Any other questions? Okay, let's thank Professor Zaleski once again.